seated. Woo! Man, I was gone last weekend. Can I just say, it is so good to be back with you. Better yet, it's so good to be back worshiping Jesus Christ with you. Man, we get to do that for eternity. How about that? Man, so good, so good. Well, much has happened since the last time that I got to open up God's Word with you, and I got to thinking that most of you know me as Pastor Britt, and I love being your pastor. I really do. But there's some other things that I thought that you should know. I want to make known to you about your campus pastor. I fell in love with my wife, Renee. She doesn't know I'm going to say this. I fell in love with my wife, Renee, way back in 1996. So that means we've been married all around 25 years. Yes. I am a blessed man. And God gave us two incredible teenagers, Mariah and Jordan, and they have made being a dad awesome. And a lot of times you'll see me and my family sitting right over here, and with us is my wonderful, beautiful mom named Joyce. She's going to get me for that. A little more about me. Way back in 1988, I went to college. Wow, I'm old. And I joined a fraternity, and I majored in English because I thought I was going to go be an English teacher and a coach at my old high school in Evanston. And then an opportunity took me away from that, and I went into business with a couple guys. And that was what God would use to bring me back to himself. You see, I got saved when I was 15, but I lived like a knucklehead for about 10 years. And it was through the desperate times of owning that business that God arrested my attention. And I said to the Lord, as about a 24-year-old, it's been a while, I said, God, you need to be more than just my Savior. You need to be the Lord of my life. And that's when I started to get serious about God. And I got discipled. And I got baptized. And then, as God seems to like to do, he did something crazy. You see, I love soccer. That was my game. That was my jam for all my life. And he gave me an opportunity to use that game that was very much like an idol in my life. He redeemed that part of me. And he gave me a chance to go into full-time vocational ministry using soccer as a way to share the gospel locally and globally. And around that same time, 1988, Renee and I found Harvest, and we fell in love with God through the ministry of the church. We grew to love God's church, and then God did something crazy again, and he called me out of that sports ministry, and he led me to join the team here at Harvest, and I became a part of the Compassion ministry, where we built this crazy, cool ministry called Harvest House, where we reached out to two of the most under-resourced communities in all of Elgin. And it was also around that time that we moved into the building up front. And there was a lot of room back then. And so a few guys, we decided to throw some weights in a room, and we made it a workout room. And so before work one day, I'm like, you know what, I'm going to go pump some iron. And I did that by myself. Bad plan. You can see already where this is going. And after pumping out some more weights, and you can see how effective that is, right? Something happened that I could never recreate and that I will always, always remember. As I was backing away from one of the weights, a plate fell, caught my left middle finger, and crushed it completely off. Ouch. Yeah. And so I was really hurting, I can promise you that. Shock consumed my body, but something else took over as well, and that was embarrassed. I was really embarrassed. I didn't want anyone to know. I didn't want to get into trouble. And so I just thought, you know, naturally, of course, being a guy, I'm just going to take my keys. I'm going to go to my car. I'm going to put keys in car, turn on car, and drive myself to the hospital. And it was on my way out of the property here that God and my body made known to me, no, not happening. And I got out of the car, and as agony was just surging through my body, I made known to anyone who could listen, I need help. And so today, we're going to continue our series through Ephesians, picking up in chapter 3. And what we're going to learn is that a mystery was made known. A mystery was made known. And this mystery was made known to some so that the gospel would be made known to all. That's why the title to our message today is Made Known. Let me pray. God, so grateful for your word. It's useful for teaching and instruction and training in righteousness so that everyone who names the name of Christ would be equipped for the good works that you would call them to do. You've called this church, Harvest Bible Chapel in Elgin, to a good work. And so use your word. Speak through this servant. Help me, oh God, please, to disappear. And may you come to the forefront and speak to us today through your word. In Jesus' name, everybody said? All right, so turn over to Ephesians 3. And as you're turning there, let's do a quick recap of this letter. So grateful for Dr. Rydelnik and the deep dives he's been doing with us into this text. In case it's been a little while, just want to do a quick review that Paul is the author, and he's likely under house arrest in Rome because of his work for Christ. And this letter is to Ephesus, which is a major city of about 250,000 people. It was located in Asia Minor, which would be present-day Turkey. And I want you to think, as Chicago is to all things shipping and logistics to all of the Midwest, Ephesus was to that region of the Roman Empire. It was a very important city, which is probably why Paul chose to start his church planting ministry there. But what about spiritually? Ephesus was mixed up. On the one hand, you had this sort of magical mysticism and a whole bunch of idolatry just all over the place. And on the other hand, you had this community of Orthodox Jews all somehow trying to exist together, probably not very well. And it was during Paul's time at Ephesus that actually some of those Jews actually chose to believe in Jesus as their Messiah, but it was to the Gentiles that Paul's most fruitful ministry happened. And you're probably wondering, well, how do you know? Well, one of the best ways to know if a conversion to Christ is authentic is through the conviction of sin. And so convicted were these new Gentile believers that in Acts 19, it says that the Gentile believers brought their books of magic valued, get this, at over 50,000 silver coins, which in today's economy would equal over a million, probably millions of dollars. And you know what they did? They burned them. And so it's to these believers in Jesus, Jew and Gentile, that Paul writes this letter. Believers who, as it says at the end of chapter 2, were being built together into a dwelling place for God. And Paul, he's the foreman on this building project. He's written this letter to help build them, and in turn, he's going to help build us today, church, into a place where the living God is working in and through us to make the mystery of God known to some, so that the gospel would be made known to all. Let's pick up in chapter 3, verse 1. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and the prophets by the Holy Spirit. So what is the Holy Spirit trying to reveal to us right now through these first five verses? Let's start with this thought. Christ reveals the mystery, even to me. Before Paul was this epic church planting pastor, he was Saul, the zealous Pharisee, passionately opposed to the way of Jesus. So strongly was he against the way of Jesus that when one of the early church leaders, Stephen, was being stoned to death, there was Paul, watching in approval. But then Paul met Jesus. And you can read all about it in Acts chapter 9, but here's what you need to know. In that moment, Jesus' words pierced Paul's heart. Christ revealed himself even to Paul, the self-righteous persecutor of Christians. For by grace, Paul was saved through faith. This wasn't of his own doing. It was the gift of God, not by works. And to grasp the importance of God's work in Paul's life, let's look at two words that he uses in these first five verses: prisoner and steward. Yeah, Paul was in prison. Paul was in prison when he wrote this letter, but this is much more than just a little circumstantial point. Paul is claiming this as his identity. Who am I? Paul says, I am a prisoner for the Lord. And why did Paul take on that identity? Look back in the text. Paul was called to reveal the mystery of the gospel to the Gentiles, those who were not Jewish. Hold on. Wait a second. Paul, a Pharisee, is ministering to Gentiles? And in case the audacity of that fact isn't clear, in those days, Orthodox Jews like Paul called Gentiles dogs. And listen, I'm not talking about that silly expression that the fellas use with each other, like, what's up, dog? No, not at all, not at all. They were dogs. To the Jews, Gentiles were nothing more than pesty, mangy dogs. Yet, here's Paul, consumed with God's radical love because of the radical revelation of God's grace in his life. And with that transformation, as his foundation, God gave Paul a ministry. And with the mindset of a prisoner, and here's the second key word, Paul stewards what had been entrusted to him. Sharing with the Gentiles the mystery that was revealed to the apostles and the prophets by the Spirit, as the text says, proclaiming to them the good news that not only can Gentiles be saved by grace, but, and you got to please be sure to get this, not only that, but that the mystery that the Jews, he's revealed the mystery that the Jews and Gentiles can be united into one body, the church. This all reminds me, this idea of a man who sold out for the Lord, reminds me of a good friend of mine here on our campus, who in a previous lifetime, long ago, he ran with a tough crowd. He fought the law and the law won, which translated into a 2-year stay courtesy of the Illinois Department of Corrections. But shortly into his time in jail, God got a hold of this guy, even him. And for the rest of his time there, let me tell you what happened. He became much more than a prisoner in the jail system. He became a prisoner of Christ Jesus. He embraced his identity, which fueled his stewardship of God's grace, his ministry to the other prisoners. He led Bible studies and prayer groups. And he shared with the men the mystery that had been revealed to him, that Christ came to save and to seek the lost. And that they, even they, prisoners, could become members like we have in the body of Christ. So, what does this mean for you? I believe Paul's identity is what we need to take from this. Paul was a prisoner, but he was the freest man on the planet. Because he had experienced the power of God's grace. What about you? Do you know Christ as Savior? If not, as we saw in the testimony today, and as we see here in the text, no matter who you are, there is no sin that's too big for God's grace to cover. Hear that today. His grace is irresistible. Today would be a great day to trust in Christ for your salvation. And if you have embraced Christ, if you do know him as your Savior, then bask, oh, bask in the favor that you've received, even you. And then, I want you to adopt a mindset, a willing mindset that believes what Jesus said, that to die to the comfortable, self-focused, self-protecting life, to die to that is to truly live. And so, Elgin, how about we be a church that chooses to say, like Paul, I, Brit, I, Renee, I, Wally, I, Denise, I, Rika, I, Marco, I, Harvest Elgin, prisoner of Christ Jesus. Well, here's the thing. Christ's work on the cross not only reconciled Jews and Gentiles to God, but also to one another. Look back at verse 6. He says, this mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. I imagine that what the believing Gentiles must have felt when they heard this news was kind of like what we see or think or feel when we're watching that wild guy on the infomercials when he says, but wait, there's more. The truth of the mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs with the Jews, the Jewish believers in the Messiah. And this was significant because there were many Jews at that time, believing Jews, who were teaching that if you, Gentile, wanted to be a believer, a part of the church, you needed to become a Jew. But Paul, a Jew, inspired by the Holy Spirit, is letting the Gentiles go like this. Because we're Gentiles. He's letting us know today. Check this out in the text. We are fellow heirs. No modification, no trimming down of the inheritance just because we're Gentiles. We're also members of the same body. Gentiles have been grafted with the Jewish believers into the body of Christ, the church. And to top it off, Gentile believers are partakers. We have a share with the Jews in the centuries-old promises of God. I want you to think of it this way. Our physical birth determines what race we are in the human race. But our spiritual birth unites us as heirs, as partakers, as members of the body of Christ, the church. Unity. It's been hard to find a whole lot of that recently in our nation, hasn't it? And while our church has definitely done some good work to promote that harmony, I think we can do better. And I want you to hear about a family who happens to be of a different race than most of us here who recently decided to move on from our church. And I'll be honest, I didn't want to reach out to talk with them about why they left, because I knew that I was going to hear some things that would be hard to hear. But eventually I did, and I was right. I heard some hard stuff. But I was glad I did. I needed to hear it. They said, "We just had a hard time reconciling coming here worshiping alongside some, not all, some who are praising a God of love and unity, but then on social media, we see those same people say things that are just so hurtful. And it made us question, are we really welcome here? Do they really care about us?" Now, let me be clear. Do I think they're speaking about all of us? No, not at all. Do I wish that they had taken more time to talk with me so that we could work it out, because that's what we do as a family? For sure. Am I growing an understanding why they felt like they did? Yeah. You see, toward the end of his time on earth, Jesus prayed a lot for us. In John 17, he prayed this: "I do not ask for these only, the followers at that time, but also for those," who's the those? It's us. "I also pray for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you. That they may also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me." Jesus gave his life so that all who would believe in him would become one. So that all who believe in him would become one. Just as he and the Father are one. And I don't know about you, but the thought of what it's going to take to see unity socially, economically, racially, it's overwhelming. But we just heard, church, that it matters to God, and so it matters to us. And here's what I want us to remember. We won't be able to do everything, but we can do something. And absolutely, there are action steps that we can take. But as I was thinking about what God would want me to share with our church family today about what we could do to take that first step of action, to move toward unity, to be the leaders in our community in this, this is what he put on my heart. What if our first step toward unity was to get low? Here's how Francis Chan put it in a discussion he had on unity. He said, "You see, we've tried the books and the conferences and the doctrinal statements, yet the church still struggles to be united and to be a force for unity. So what if we tried silence? What about a silent, reverent awe? What if we humbled ourselves, waking up every morning in awe of who God is? What if we just imagined his throne, this being who sits in unapproachable light where angels are covering themselves, just crying out how holy, holy, holy God is? What if we got back to actually having a fear of God? Like those times in the Bible when someone got a glimpse of God and they fell speechless. Like Job when he said, 'I'd always heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you, and now I'll just stop talking. Suddenly he was humbled and embarrassed by all the things that he had said that were just so arrogant. What if we recognize that it's not about me, not what I want, it's about what God wants. So church, what does God want? God wants his kingdom to come and his will to be done on earth, in America, in Illinois, in the Fox Valley, in Elgin, in Harvest Bible Chapel, Elgin. He wants his will to be done here as it is in heaven. And in heaven right now and forever, there's a unified awe of God. And so what if unity starts that way? What if God saw in Elgin a group of people huddled together in awe of him, praying, "Our Father, hallowed be your name. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. We want it here on earth as it is in heaven." And when we do that, church, Jesus says what? The world will believe. You see, if the mystery is going to be made known through us, and it's on us to remember, Christ unites with the mystery. So when we're willing to embrace that reality, and we'll find this last point to be true, Christ provides purpose through the mystery. What the church does matters for eternity. Look with me back in verse starting in 7. Of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. Paul's going back to that personal way of speaking that he was saying at the beginning of this passage. As we've come to expect with Paul, he just can't get over the fact that God chose him, even him, the great persecutor of the church, to receive the gospel grace and to be a minister of the gospel, still grace. Yet Paul was quick to acknowledge something, that this ministry was possible only due to a source outside of himself. My friend John here works with cars, and it's so cool, isn't it, man? How all these automakers are making these new electric cars. They're so cool, aren't they? But I'll tell you what, if they don't have power, they're nothing. That's why it's great that Paul says here in verse 7 that the only way he was saved, the only way that he's able to do this ministry is through power. His power? No, God's power. And the word that Paul uses here, it's a cool Greek word. Up on the screen, you'll see it. It says dynamio. That should actually sound kind of familiar. Dynamio, it's where we get our word for. You got it. Paul experienced God's dynamite power. Dynamite. I couldn't resist it. All right. Paul experienced God's dynamite power early in his Christian life, being transformed from persecutor to apostle. And he's saying here that it's only his supernatural power, that dynamia, divine power that's fueling his ministry to the Gentiles. A ministry that's a gift of grace to preach to the Gentiles the riches. No, Not just riches. What does the text say? Unsearchable, unfathomable riches that are available to all who follow Christ, Jew and Gentile. Back to the text in verse 9. Paul says he's there to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery, hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. Paul isn't only to deliver the message of the ministry, he's here to bring it to light. He's here to unpack it. A plan that was hidden, but according to the text, was now revealed by who? The Creator. The Creator, God. Think builder, designer, author, the one in charge. And the one in charge says that his plan to reveal the mystery, look back in verse 10, is through the church. And churches who embrace that call, like the Ephesians did, become a showcase for God's manifold wisdom. That word manifold occurs only here in all of the New Testament, so it must be pretty special. And it means, get this, having a great variety of forms that causes one to marvel at its extraordinary beauty, kind of like a diamond in a ring, like a diamond in an engagement ring. These are my friends, Jacob and Jacqueline, and they're getting married this month. I'm so excited. Are you here, Jacob? No? All right. Maybe. All right, well, it's okay. We'll laugh and celebrate with you. All right, so they're getting married later this month, and it was way back in early 2020 that Jacob popped the question to Jacqueline at none other than the Wake Up Student Ministry Conference. Watch this video quick.
Jacob Callahan and Jacqueline Johnson.
We're very excited.
Oh my
so
goodness.
So come on up. No. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Jacqueline. Congratulations.
I'm top. Here, I feel like these should go to you. That, and I'll give you this. Jacob Callahan and
Well, on that day, Jacob, yeah, let's go. Jacqueline still likes him after that really very public. Wow. Good job, Jacqueline. Well, on that day when Jacob put that diamond ring on his bride-to-be's finger, she marveled at its design. I've seen it. I think there's a picture. It's well done. Well done. And in the same way that Jacqueline had no idea that that moment was coming, the text, it's clear. It's letting us know that there were no one in the spiritual realm, no angelic beings knew how God was going to unfold his marvelous plan. But now that it's been revealed, all the rulers, all the authorities in the spiritual realm can only marvel at God's manifold wisdom. That it's going to be displayed through his bride, the church. We're the church. This is us. And that's why what the church does matters for eternity. And churches who get this, we're fulfilling our ultimate purpose to bring glory to God. One last look in the text, picking up in verse 11. Paul says, "This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I'm suffering for you, which is your glory." God had an eternal purpose, church, and it was accomplished in Christ. And because of Christ's accomplishment, all who are saved by grace have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. Boldness and access, they're kind of like two sides to the same coin. Through our faith in Christ, we can speak to God, our Father, with the sweet candidness that you would have with a friend. We can also, we can approach God. And get this, we can do that confidently, certain that he's listening. And it's possible that Paul brings this up to the Ephesians because look back in verse 13. Instead of being grieved over his imprisonment, he wants the Ephesians to know that what he's suffering on their behalf was worth it. Because the mystery had been made known. And now he believes that through their church, the gospel will be made known to all. And it was in Acts chapter 19, verse 10, Luke tells us that the work continued for 2 years so that all who dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks, the early church. Man, they got it. They found their purpose through the mystery. And because of what they did, their work will matter for eternity. And so what does this mean for us? Back in January, when I was last able to preach, we talked about this idea of having a one life. This is a movement that I have been praying would just become a part of who we are. You see, one of the marks of a Christ follower is that they're missional, going out. And all of us who have been redeemed by God's amazing grace, well, we should be burdened for any who don't yet know the Lord. And then intentionally pursuing them with the hope of the gospel, praying, investing, and inviting. And so who could be your one life? Is it a neighbor? Is it a friend? Is it a classmate, a teammate? Is it a colleague? Is it a relative? If you don't have a deep friendship with them, that's okay. That's kind of the point. And here's what we're going to do. Here's what we're going to do with these one lives that God is putting on your heart right now. First, we're going to pray daily. We're going to ask God to make that person aware of Christ's love and their deep need for him. Secondly, we're going to invest weekly. We're going to look for and we're going to create ways to invest in people's lives every single week. And the hope is to build, key word, relationship. Where we get to share Christ's love with them because we've built trust with them. Listen, these aren't projects. These are people. And our aim is to love them in the way we would want to be loved. And finally, we're going to invite them to the next right thing. Maybe that's a barbecue at your house this summer. Maybe it's to go shopping. Maybe it's to one of the wonderful summer events we're going to have here on the campus, or as so many of you do regularly, invite them to a worship service here on a Sunday morning. Listen, the sacred mystery that was so important to Paul, to the Gentiles in Ephesus, and even to the angels, mystery is now in our hands. So speaking of hands, a few more things that were made known to me back when I lost the tip of my middle finger. I learned that I can get into pretty big trouble if I don't put a little explanation behind when I show someone my middle finger that lost the top of it. Don't like to get in trouble for that. Typing, that's another thing that changed. I'll never be able to type the same way. But here's this. I got into trouble that day because I was by myself. And then I tried to get out of the mess that I got myself in by myself. I got humbled that day. And for the last 2 years, I want you to know it was a beautiful privilege to be able to serve as the interim campus pastor. And yet today, as I stand before you, opening God's word for the first time as your campus pastor, I find myself humbled again. I am a man of faults and weaknesses. I struggle with insecurity every day. I make a lot of mistakes. And if you had told me that 15 years ago I would be standing here in this role doing this, I would have said you are crazy. Doing this feels like the biggest risk of my life. And you know what? It's worth it. Thank you. Because here's what I do know. Renee and I love you so much. I couldn't wait to get back here today. And we feel so loved by you. Yeah, thank you. And there is no other group of people we would want to be arm in arm with building God's kingdom than with every single one of you. And we're here. We are here to serve you and to lead you, to help our church fulfill the purpose that God has given to us as his church. You see, 15 years ago, when God gave us this property, he did so much more than that. He placed us in a community. And I believe with all my heart, because of what I know about God from his word, that he is up to something big here. He's using the pain that we've endured as a church to prune us and to refine us. He's using his word to strengthen us. He's given us a new lead teaching pastor. He's doing all of that and more. Why? Because he redeems the life of his servants. God is doing a work in us, and he's eager to do a work through us that is more than we could have ever imagined. The mystery was made known so that through us, the gospel would be made known to Elgin and beyond. Amen. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the privilege to open your word today. We are so grateful for the good work that you have started in each of us personally and collectively. We are a force to be reckoned with, not because there's anything special about us, but because of you, Jesus Christ, the head of this church, and you are doing a work among us that is more than we could have ever have imagined. If you peel back the curtain to reveal even just an iota of what you're up to, we would fall apart. But we can get a sense, God, because of the few things that you've revealed to us, that you are doing so much more that we are excited. And we can't wait to see, God, all the things that you are going to do. Still in us, we're a work in progress. We need you to keep doing the work in us, God, so that then through us, you would have vessels through which you could just pour it out, God. Pour it out through us so that we would be a blessing of grace and mercy and truth and love and hope to a community that is so desperate for all of those things. We love you, Jesus. You are the reason that we are here. And in your name we pray, the name that is above every name, Jesus Christ the Lord. And the church said, amen. Amen. Let's worship.